Okay, so honestly, I couldn't find anywhere scripture where God limits our creative expression just with the two of us. I couldn't find anywhere. So I've really tried my best to find somewhere, but I couldn't find any scripture. And some things are obviously a sin, okay? I've already said it. But as far as would you agree up on creative expression or positions or whatever, I didn't see any limitation. I want to read you a verse in Songs of Solomon, verse 4. It says, "Awaken, north wind. Come, south wind. Blow on my garden and spread the fragrance of its spices. Let my love come to his garden and eat its choicest fruits." Okay, so that's a hectic verse, this one. We're on the whole thing of blow on my garden, the whole thing of eat the choices. So it doesn't matter how I try to explain this verse to you. I believe there's some freedom in this verse. I mean, you can eat, come and eat of the choicest fruit. I mean, there's freedom. All right. So I believe there's freedom in this whole thing. So just to answer the question for that person, I hope they hear. There's some things that you obviously cannot do. Okay, that's in a limitation. It's biblical. It's a sin. So do not do it. Okay. Number two, make sure that you agree upon them what is acceptable to both of you. Okay, the both of you. Point number three, in the New Testament, there's a scripture that says, "Honor your spouse and respect your spouse." So please don't ever push your spouse into something he or she is uncomfortable. Okay, but whatever, there can be no limitation. Okay. Question number two. If we are not going to have sex, can I stay the night with my girlfriend or go away on a little getaway? Okay, that's a good, well, that's a good question. I want to tell you this, Romans 4 verse 13. Let's start with the verse. "Therefore, let us no longer criticize one another, but instead decide not to put a stumbling block or pitfall in your brother's way." So let's say you are strong enough. Okay, let's say that you are strong enough not to have sex while you're on a getaway or while you're at the night. You may set a bad example to someone else who says, "Oh, they are staying the night together. Maybe we can." And then you may cause stumbling and do something. And then that person or that couple will do something that will be damaging to them. That's why my scripture says, do not be a stumbling block to one another. Don't be a stumbling block to your brother. 1 Thessalonians 5 verse 22 on this question says, stay away from every form of evil. So, if you love this girl, gentlemen, guard her reputation. If you really love her, guard her reputation and also guard yours. Because remember, you are building your life story. You are building your life story, and let's not do something that we would be ashamed of to talk later on or 10 years on. Because I believe, like I said last week, I believe your kid are going to come to you, your children, and says one day, "Listen, how does daddy and mommy meet?" And then you don't want to tell them that we met through a whatever, or through a strip club, or through a whatever. You want to build your relationship, and then you want to tell them, "Listen, we met in the church, or we met somewhere where we met somewhere." So that's a question. And then if all the scriptures and all the things I just said doesn't work for you, I've read an article on the Alcoholic Anonymous, and they say something when it comes to temptation. They say, "Don't go where it's slippery." Okay, all right. Question number three, how do I get to know someone without becoming emotionally vulnerable? That was a good question for me. How do I get to know someone without becoming emotionally vulnerable? My answer, to really get to know someone, at some point, you have to really be somewhat vulnerable. To really need to know someone. But the problem I do have with this is that too many people do emotional vomiting, okay? It's just vomiting and it's just vomiting and vomiting. They meet someone and then they say, "Hey, here's it all." And then they just start emotional vomiting and they just pour out their whole life story for the person just in front of them or the couple or the date they are. And then they give their hearts away way too early in a relationship. Again and again and again and again. And we don't want to do that. We don't want to do that. So the question is, how can we guard our hearts? How can you guard our hearts? And we cannot. We cannot completely guard our hearts, but we want to be open up appropriately for the appropriate stage of the relationship. Because there are stages in relationships. And it's just the same as a car. There's steer one, well, rat one, rat two, whatever you call it. So there's few levels. And you cannot open up your heart on level one. It's not possible to do that. Well, you cannot. Well, it's possible, but don't do it. Just wait for level three or four just to start. And I believe that levels, I went to the set, listen, but what's the levels? So I think level one is just few dating, just go out for coffee or whatever. Level two is you start really to know one another and just be closer or spending more time. And level three is start dating with this. Level four is engagement. And level five is marriage. And level six. So I believe you can open up your heart on level three when you really know that, listen, yeah, this is the girl I want to date for the next. And I believe if you 25 and up, don't mess with a girl's heart. And don't mess with the boys. If you're 25 and you sit here and you say, listen, ek gaan nie met hierdie oukie langs my trou nie. Moenie verder uitgaan nie, want julle is besig om kort tyd serious te mors. Okay. Because that person have to go to level one again. Or the girl have to go to level one again. So there's few levels. Okay? So please open up your heart just a little bit on level one, just a little bit on level two, maybe more on level three, and then obviously engagement. You have to open up your heart seriously, seriously. Do not prematurely open up and sharing too much of our hearts. And while we're on this point in leveling, and levels, there was a question asking me, how long do you need to date before you can get engaged? Okay? And my question was about 5 or 6 years. I'm just joking. Haha, vang ook van julle nou lekker. Depending on the levels. Okay, depending where you go. Maybe you're a fast car and then you go level 1, 1, 2, 2, 2, 3, 4, and then 6. Maybe you're a person that's going level 1, level 2, level 3. So depending on what? So depending on your levels of relationship. Okay? Alicia and I were, I think it'd been 4 years. We were dating 4 years before we ever go to level 4. But in my mistake, I made a mistake. This is for me. This is not for you. We made a mistake by our level 4 and level 5. Dating till married, it's about 14 or 15 months. And that was too long for me. That's for me. I would level 5 to level 6, I would go way faster, about 7 or 8 months. Because you're already engaged and, okay. So that was my obviously financial and whatever. Okay, that's for you. So do not prematurely open up and sharing too much of your heart. Question there. Question number 4. This was the most difficult one. So this is the most difficult one. I am dating a non-believer. What do I do? I'm dating a non-believer. What do I do? Now this is the most. That was the most complex question because I don't want to offend people now. Okay, I will offend you. Give me a month and I'll offend you. But I don't want to offend you now. Okay. I don't want to offend you now, especially for the new people. I don't want to offend you. So this is a complex. I just chose to give you some scripture and let's just read the scripture and then let's decide what the scripture says about us. 1 Corinthians 7. Also, if any woman, this is for you, has an unbelieving husband and he's willing to live with her, she must not leave her husband. For the unbelieving husband is sanctified by the wife, and the unbelieving wife is sanctified by the Christian husband. Otherwise, your children would be unclean, but now they are holy. But if the unbeliever leaves, let him leave. A brother or a sister is not bound in such cases. God has called you to peace. Okay. For wife, how do you know whether you will save your husband or your husband, how do you know whether you will save your wife? Okay, well, eindig ons. Now, let's do number 2, Peter 3. Let's go to the next one as well. Peter 3, verse 1 to 2. Wives, in the same way, submit yourself to your husband so that even if some disobey the Christian message, they may be won over without a message by the way their wives live, when they observe your pure, reverent lives. Okay, so that's just a few questions I don't want to answer to. There's a book you can read, Surviving a Spiritual Mismatch. Okay, how to survive a spiritual mismatch. Because the Bible says don't be yoked together. An unbeliever and a believer can't be yoked together. I cannot yoke a lion and a camel together. It won't work. I cannot yoke a camel and an elephant together. It won't work. The same way, you cannot yoke a Christian and a believer and a non-believer together, because they've got way different views of children, way different views on money, way different views on how to pray and how to use time. So it won't work. But if you're in a relationship right now with a person, the Bible says that if you want to leave, just say, "Ja, skop om gaat, dan gaan hy." But if you don't, if he want to stay with you, then he have to respect your ways, your time, the way you spend your money, the way he did. And Peter said, just wives, just submit under your wives. Eventually they will see, yes, Sima, jy is eintlik dierbaar. Okay, en dan gaan hulle ook dierbaar word. Okay. Question number 5. Here we are moving. We are moving. Number 5. How do you bring God into your relationship? How do you bring God into your relationship? Now there was a good question for me, and there was a question on the category. There was also a question, how do I become a spiritual leader? I believe that the writing told me there was a man. I believe so. So how do I become a spiritual leader? And honestly, when the moment I started researching on this, I believe that there was a lot of women was whining and a lot of women was complaining, not you, on the social media, because their husbands were not spiritual leaders. And they were always complaining about, my husband is not a spiritual leader. And I've seen a lot of spouses want their men to be this major theologians and major do Bible study and pray till 4 o'clock in the morning. And a lot of them are whining because my husband is not a spiritual leader. He cannot do Bible study. My husband is not a spiritual leader. He cannot even pray for 5 minutes or 10 minutes. And so let me say this. I believe Bible study and I believe prayer should be a big part of bringing Christ into your families and into your relationships. I believe that. That's a big part. If you do not do it in your relationship now, I really encourage you to start doing Bible study together, start praying together. It will change your relationship from here to immediately there. So do that. Okay? But I want to ask the ladies this question. I'll tell the ladies, if that's what you're searching for, if you are searching for a man that's a godly, that's a spiritual leader and that's doing Bible study and doing prayer meetings or whatever, I want to tell you this. I believe that you are shooting way too low. I believe that you are shooting way too low. Because why? Because the moment you do that, you put your whole life into certain areas. Compartimente, is die mooie Afrikaanse woord. You're putting your life all in these areas and you believe that, okay, this is the normal life and this is our Bible study life. And this is our normal life and this is our prayer life and this is my normal husband and this is my Bible study husband. And this is my normal husband and this is my also. So we put life into all sort of areas. But the key for me in this question, how do I bring God in your relationship, is that we have to spiritual impact our relationship. We want Christ to be in every area of our life and not just in our Bible study time. Okay? So we don't want a relationship and it's going good just the Bible study time, but then we have our normal life and we go do whatever we want. But in our Bible study time, we put on our Bible hat, Bible caps, and then we do Bible study. Okay, and then we put off the cap, bear and unlock us with us will. So we want Christ to be the area of the life, in each and every area of our life. That's why I believe a godly spiritual leader may be someone who's full of integrity. I believe a spiritual godly leader may be someone who lays down his life to serve his spouse or to serve his wife. Someone, a spiritual leader, is someone who is a godly role model. And the moment you're just that, the moment you're not just the Bible study guy or the prayer guy, but you're the godly one or you're the one that lays down your life for your wife, then the moment you're that, then you're hitting every target.
Every moment. Because then when it comes to sickness, you're hitting the target. When it comes to prayer and this, you're hitting the target. When it comes to difficult situations or difficult decisions, you are hitting the target. And then you're not just a great Bible teacher or whatever, but you're just more. You're more like Christ. And then the moment you're more like Christ, you do want to do Bible study. And you really do want to set a great example. And you certainly do want to be a Christ follower that's also fun and things. And then you start bringing God into your relationship. Because then God is your whole relationship and not just the Bible study God. Or the prayer walk, God, or the whatever, but the whole area of your life. So here's the question, how do you bring God in your relationship? Be more like Jesus. Even if you go out on a dinner, even if you go out on movies, even if you play peekaboo, even if you, whatever you do, just do it with a godly heart. Do it with a godly, and then obviously, I've got an example. I've got an example. We've watched ek en Alisa kyk getroud met rugby. Ek weet ons sak. Dis al dis doen. Want ek is skoot kombersie en dan brei ek. Dan brei ek blokkies sodat ek 'n kombersie kan hikkel. Ek grap net. Okay. So we do getroud met rugby. Okay. So there was an episode I think 2 weeks or 3 weeks ago. There was an episode. One man came in and hit all the women there in the house. I don't know. Maybe you know about the story or whatever. And we didn't obviously knew that was the scene or whatever. So we checked the episode while our kids were there. And they saw this, and Milanay immediately afterwards came to us and said, "Mama, Papa, ons kan hierdie kyk nie. Jesus kindertjies kyk dit nie." And immediately ek en Alisa het mekaar gekyk and we said, "Oh man." We never said something about it, but she already knew that, listen here, because of my mother and because of my father that has spiritual or godly character in them, and they do, we know that, listen here, we cannot do this. We cannot say that. Even Zaili, ons middelkind, even every night when I give the milk and say, lekker slaapies, dan sê sy, bid papa, jy het vergeet. Dan sê ek, ek sal onthou. So then we start bringing God into a relationship with not even once, we not even say, sit still, there's no Bible study time. We just bring a Bible study in while we're doing whatever we do. Okay, we are moving. Last question, can you believe it? Number 6, I'm in a relationship. I'm in a relationship. How much should I reveal about my sexual past? I'm in a relationship. How much should I reveal about my sexual past? And that was a good question. And that's why I want to end with this question, because it was a good question. All of a sudden, now you're getting married, and you've never told your spouse or whatever about your woman or about your sex life or about whatever life you have. And immediately, the one you told, you said, "Listen," or the woman says, or the wife says, "Are you going to compare me? Because now, after marriage, we're going to do, and then are you going to compare me? Am I going to be as good as Sunny?" Immediately compare. So here's my opinion on this, what the Bible says. The Bible is clearly on this. The Bible says, do not lie. The Bible says, do not lie. So I want to tell you this, and I want to encourage you that we're never going to lie. Okay? But my recommendation is that you don't give a ton of detail when you tell about your sexual past. Tell about it. Be open about it. Be honest about it. Don't lie about it. But don't give a detail. Okay. Sit nie nodig om te weet wat die meisiekind aangehad het nie. Okay. Don't give a detail because I believe the devil is in detail. Okay. So don't give detail. And then the second one of this question is, if Jesus can forgive that person, I believe you can. If God and Jesus can forgive your sexual past, I believe you can. And then it's up to you to make decisions. So listen, I don't want to hold our past into our new, brand new relationship. We started a series on season one, episode one. Okay. We started on week one. We said, to really be fulfilled in life, you have to find the one. Who's the one? Jesus is the one. Jesus is the one. Your spouse in your relationship
is number two. And the moment we have a God-centered relationship. The Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. Seek first. Seek first. Seek first God, and then all the rest will follow. But you have to seek first God. I want to end the exact same way I've ended last week. Because so many people are sitting here tonight believing, yeah, what do we do? I'm in big trouble, Eric. All of the questions, all of the answers, this whole series of Love All the Way made me feel disqualified. Made me feel that I'm not good enough. Made me feel that, you know what? I've messed up big time. And now what? Can I ever be happy again? Can I ever change my life again? There's a scripture that says, if anyone is in Christ, he's a brand new person. The old is gone, and everything new has come. The old is gone, and everything new has come. I want to tell you this. Doesn't matter if you've messed up. Doesn't matter if you've messed up. In Christ, you can be new. Doesn't matter if you've messed up. In Christ, you can be set free. Doesn't matter if you've messed up. In Christ, you can be completely healed. Doesn't matter if you've messed up. In Christ, you can overcome that attention, that addiction to pornography. You can overcome that addiction of masturbation. You can overcome that addiction of whatever you have. Doesn't matter if you've messed up. In Christ, you can be free. And God is drawing a line tonight. He's drawing a line. And I believe Jesus is asking you, where are you in this line? Are you still there? Or are you coming to my way tonight? Stepping over the line, say, God, I want to be brand new in this relationship. I've messed up. I've got a sexual past. You won't believe it. But I want to step over into your side. I want to have a brand new life. I want to start a new relationship with this amazing girl I have next to me. Or this amazing boy I have next to me. And we want to start new. We want to be godly relationship. We want to be someone new. We want to show younger generations that, listen here, it is possible for two people to stay in love forever. Because you know this possible. It's possible for two people to stay in love forever. It is possible. It's possible. But you have to step over that line tonight and say, Father, I want to be brand new. And God is asking you this question. Are you stepping? Are you stepping the line? And God will set you free. And the word says, whoever He sets free is free indeed. God wants to set you free tonight from whatever your relationship was. And He wants to make you brand new. In Jesus' name. I want to start off tonight. Yeah, come on, do that. If you are, let's start with the singles. If you're single tonight, looking for the two, not the one, the two, because the one is Jesus. If you're single tonight, I want you to stand up. If you're single, if you're looking for someone, if you're not looking for someone, sit down then. I don't know. Jy's getroud.
Ongelukkig.
Yeah. Okay. If you're single and if you're looking for someone, if you don't look for someone, we will, as jy net soos wil eensaam doodgaan, is dit ook alright. Sit still. Ek sal later vir jou bid. Okay. I want to pray for your singles first. So Father, thank you. Just stretch out your hand, Father. Father, just thank you for each and every single person in this place. Father, I pray that you will work with them. Father, I pray that they will be the person that loves you, a person that has godly character, a person that really looking or searching for the one. Father, and then while they're searching for the one, Father, they will find the two. the one that will support them, the one that will encourage them, the one that will change them. So many of them, Father, so many of the single person sitting here tonight feeling, I've messed up, man. I don't know if I've ever can get someone. Father, I just pray that you will send them the right one on the right time. Father, that you will just send them. That they will be in love. That they will get this tingling, wingling feeling of love, Jesus. But while they wait, Father, let them wait upon you. Because the song says, strength will rise as we wait upon you. Let me just wait upon you. Keep them waiting upon you, Father. In Jesus' name. Singles, julle kan sit. Almal wat in 'n verhouding is. Everyone that's in a relationship. Relationship, relationship, relationship. If you're in a relationship. Sorry, is die huis nou? Ja. Okay, I just want to pray for you. Father, just... Ag, jy kan maar jou ou, jy kan maar jou meisie se hand vashou. Father, just thank you for every single relationship in this place, Father. Thank you that they could find love at this stage in their life. Father, and there's so many relationships tonight feeling that we want to go to the next level, Father. It's time for engagement. It's time for open up my heart. It's fine. It's time for whatever, Father. And I just want to pray for each and every relationship. Father, I pray that you will just anoint them. Father, I pray that you will give them wisdom, Father, to make the right decision. Father, I just pray that they will follow you, that they will read your, that they will have Bible study time with you, that they will pray together. Father, they will grow together, Father. But and as a couple, that they will grow closer to you, Father. I pray there's some couples here, Father, that's seriously, really on engagement or almost married, Father. And I just want to pray for them as well. And I pray that in this time, Father, that they just will keep on enjoying you, Father. Just keep on enjoying you. Keep on searching for you. Keep on seeking for you, Father. And help them, Father, to show an example to the younger ones. It's a younger generation. How do we do relationships the right way, the godly way? Thank you, Father. I pray that love will blossom, Father, for them. In Jesus' name. Amen. Couples, julle kan almal wat getroud is. As jy getroud is, dan wil ek hê jy moet nou staan. Ja. As jy gelukkig getroud is, kan jy sit. Nee, ek grap staan. As jy getroud is. Waar sit Alisha? Staan sy, daar by die deur uit, ja. Ok, oor sy lê plat. Alright. Father, just thank you for each and every married couple. Father, thank you that I can just pray the covenant over them again. Father, you made marriage. Father, you said in your word that it's no good for one person to stay alone, but Father, just to be tied together, one unit again, one spirit again. Father, and I just pray for every married couple, whether they married for 60, 70, 100 years, and even that they married just for a few months. Father, I pray that their love will just overflow. Father, I pray that their marriages will be better and better and better and better and better. Father, that from tonight on they will go into a next level, even in level 8, 9 or 10, Father, in their relationship. That whatever they do, Father, that things will just happen for them. Father, I pray that your anointing on married couple just will move. Father, I pray that the time they gave their ring away, Father, that you will just seal them again. And says, listen, you made a covenant before me that you will love me and you will love your spouse forever and forever and forever till death do us part. Father, and I just pray that whatever we do, Father, that we will just keep on loving one another, keep on searching for one another, keep on searching for marriage. Father, that we will show all the ones that is in a relationship that, listen, your marriage can work. We live in a world, Father, where divorce rates are so high. And Father, I pray that we will be a church and we will be people that will not. We will love one another forever and forever and forever and forever. Thank you, Father, for them. Thank you for each and every marriage. We love them, Father, and I know that you love them. Even spice up, Father. Father, I just ask you to spice up their marriage, Father, like the Songs of Solomon says, that we can do cool stuff in marriages, Father. And can do great stuff in marriage. And help them, give them wisdom, give them time, give them ideas for them to do so that they can be happily, even more happily ever after. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Het ek vir iemand nie gebid nie, wat jy bijvoorbeeld nie opgestaan het vir iets nie. Is daar iemand wat nie opgestaan het vir iets nie? Want jy, soos bijvoorbeeld, ek weet nie, jy is verlief op een foto. Jy is ver, ja, complicated. Facebook status. Okay, so as jy nie opgestaan het nie, as jy nie opgestaan het nie, jy wou nie opgestaan het nie, want jy is verlief op een donkie of iets, kom laat ek vir jou kan bid, okay? Dan bid ons vir jou en die donkie. Amen. Volgende week, well, next week, I'm starting with a new series, and I already said it, the new series is called, If You Die, What Happens To You? 1 minute after you die, what happens to you? So that's a cool series for me. So the moment you die, what's happening to you? I'm going to show you in the Word what's happening.